GenerateBlocks Pro 2.3 was just announced, and with it comes two new extremely powerful features. The first is the ability to create mega menus, pop-ups, and flyout menus through the new overlay panels feature. This is something I wasn't sure would ever come to GenerateBlocks, but now that it's here, I'm absolutely stoked on just how powerful and easy to use this system is. I've already put out a video on how the mega menu system works, and I'll remind you at the end of the video to check that one out as well. Second, and what might end up being the sneaky star of this update, is the conditions builder. For now, they're only bound to our overlay panels, but I can't see a reason why GenerateBlocks wouldn't extend this system into the rest of their ecosystem as well. If you're familiar with the plugin block visibility, this is going to do a lot of those same things and maybe even eliminate the need for having an additional plugin just for that functionality. In today's video, we're going to take a look at all of it. I'll get you up to speed on everything you need to know in order to start using these features, and we'll take a look at a few cool examples. If that sounds interesting to you, then stick around and let's get started. I've got the alpha version of the GenerateBlocks Pro 2.3 installed. In fact, this is actually a pre-alpha version, so I could get this video recorded to sync up with the release. I mention all that just to say that things might look different on your end as this goes through the alpha and beta phases. You'll only want to upgrade this in testing environments until we get a stable release. But once you install 2.3, you'll notice you have two new menu options under GenerateBlocks inside the dashboard. This is Overlay Panels and Conditions. We'll start off with the Overlay Panels and we'll come back to the conditions towards the end of this video. After clicking into the overlay panel screen, here you'll be able to create new panels and see all the panels that you have saved on your website. You can also categorize your panels, which doesn't have any effect on the appearance or functionality, but could help you organize things on the back end for sites that have a whole lot of them. We'll click the dropdown on the Add New button and see we have three types of panels to choose from. That's Standard, Anchored, and Mega Menu. All of these have slightly modified functionality for particular use cases. You can choose this here as you create your new panel, but you don't have to. All of these options are available to switch between at any time. So for now, we'll just hit Add New and choose our panel type once we start configuring things. For our first example, I think we'll just set up this typical pop-up. Once you've entered the panel screen, things should look pretty familiar. And I think this is the first major advantage to how the Generate team built this feature. Creating overlay panels is just like creating anything else with GenerateBlocks, just with a few more settings. You can use any block you want to inside your panels, and you have all the same styling options, which means there isn't really too much new to learn. What is new is the overlay panel tab at the top of the settings panel. This is where you typically see page or post, but of course here you're seeing overlay panel, and all of your settings are here. So let's go through all of them briefly, and we'll build something out to start testing. First, we have the overlay panel type, which is what we saw in that drop-down menu on the last screen. This allows us to choose between the standard, anchored, or mega menu types. Depending on which overlay type you select, you do have a few different options below. We'll start off with the standard type, but we're going to skip the display conditions and come back to that again later. Then you choose your trigger type. This is one of the settings that has different options depending on which panel type you select. Since we're here on the standard overlay panel, we have the most trigger options, including click, hover, click and hover, exit intent, percentage scrolled, time delay, and even custom events, which you can hook into things like add to cart in WooCommerce, for example. For now, let's just set up a timed panel, which will make it easy for us to test. So I'll go ahead and select time delay. When I do, you'll see a new field appear where we can set the delay in milliseconds. I'll just set this to 500 or 1/2 second just to make things easy to test. After that, you can set the duration of how long you want the pop-up to go away after it's been dismissed by a user. So if they close the pop-up and you don't want to bother them with it again for a day, you could set this to 24 hours. If you leave it blank or set it to 0, it will trigger every time even if they dismiss it. We'll go ahead and leave that blank for the demo since we'll be testing, but you'll probably want to set this to something that won't totally annoy your visitors. Next, we get into a bit of the styling for your pop-up. The Show Backdrop checkbox is checked by default, and here you can select the backdrop color with the color picker. This is going to be the area that shows back behind your pop-up and kind of shades your website to make the pop-up stand out. You can turn this off if you don't need it, and there are use cases where you probably wouldn't, but I'm going to go ahead and leave it on for now. Next, we have an input field for backdrop blur. This creates a blurred effect on your website back behind your pop-up. You can set this in pixel values, and you want to be pretty conservative with the number. Something like 5 will actually blur things quite a bit, so we'll go ahead and set it to 5 pixels so you can see exactly what that looks like when we test things out on the front end. After that, we can set the position of the pop-up. Again, this is going to be context dependent based on the type of overlay panel you're using, but here, since we're using the standard pop-up, we have all these different options. I'm going to go ahead and just select center, which will make sure our pop-up shows in the center of the screen both vertically and horizontally. Now after that, we have a few configuration checkboxes. You'll probably want to leave the close on escape key checked, which will help all your keyboard users. Close on click outside is checked by default, which is also a behavior that I think most users will expect, where they can click the backdrop and close your modal. Disable page scroll is not checked by default, but if you check it, that will keep people from being able to scroll your website while the pop-up is open. Again, that's going to be dependent on what you're using your pop-up for. Sometimes you might want that and sometimes you might not. After that are our animation options. There are options for fading and sliding in from every direction, for both when the pop-up appears and when it's dismissed. We'll go ahead and do a fade in and fade out, but you can play around with those options and see what works best for you. You can also control the animation duration. There's a duration on here by default, which looks great, so I'm just going to leave that blank. But if you wanted to go in and make it faster or slower, you can set all of that here in milliseconds. After that, we have the width mode, where we can choose between the max content or full width. Max content will make the width of your panel only as wide as the content inside of it. Full width will, of course, make your panel full width. Now you do have control of that once you add a container to the page to hold your modal. There you'll have all the size settings you're used to, so you can adjust those and set explicit widths there. But let's go ahead and get a panel built out so we have something to look at. We'll go ahead and test some of the different trigger options and the settings that come with them. Like I said, the new overlay panel system allows you to build things just like you would build out any page or post inside GenerateBlocks. So for that reason, I'm not going to make you sit here and watch me add containers and images and text to the page. We'll just go ahead and paste in something I already created and continue setting up this pop-up. Here we have just a simple pop-up with a white background, an image, some text, and a form. I just built this the same way I would build anything inside GenerateBlocks. You can see here, if I select the container and go into my block settings, that I've set the max width to 600 pixels. That was just to ensure that my pop-up doesn't get any wider than those 600 pixels. And since we've got all of these things configured, we can go ahead and test this out on the front end. Notice that I didn't add any display conditions here, which will mean this is going to appear on every page of the website by default. Now we'll go ahead and check things on the front end, and the pop-up should appear within a half second. And just like that, there it is. You can see the overlay color is set to the dark gray that I set in the settings panel, and the background behind it is blurred 5 pixels just like we instructed. You can use the escape key to close a pop-up, you can click here anywhere in the backdrop, or you can click that close button that I inserted inside the panel. Now I prefer having a close button, but you do have to assign the button to close the pop-up, so let me show you how I did that. Back here inside the editor, we'll select the button I use for my close button. We'll go back to the block tab, then in the settings, and under advanced, you'll find a dropdown for overlay panel trigger. Here, you'll just want to select close open overlay panel. The overlay panel trigger is also what we're going to be using if we want to trigger a panel by clicking or hovering over an item. So let's go ahead and reconfigure our pop-up to open on click instead of a time delay so we can see how that works. Back here inside our overlay panel, I'm going to change the trigger type to click. Now the pop-up won't open after the half second delay, it will only open up on click. Of course, we need to decide what we're going to click, so let's go ahead and save these changes and take a look on the front end. Let's say we want this Book Now button to open up the pop-up we created. It lives inside my header, so I'll go ahead and open up the header element. Here, we'll select that button and remove the link it had, and change the tag name from an A to a button. A link takes you somewhere and a button performs an action, and since this will be opening up a pop-up, we want this to be a button tag instead of a link. Now by default, buttons come with a border, so we're going to have to go into the border settings and remove that, and then we can follow the same steps we did for the close button by going to the settings panel, into advanced, and then selecting the pop-up we created under the overlay panel trigger. This will link the button in our header with the pop-up we created so that when we click the button, the modal will appear. Let's test it out and see if it works. We'll save our changes, open it up on the front end again, and click the button. And just like magic, there it is. Had we selected hover instead of click in our trigger, the modal would have opened up on hover instead. I don't think we need to go through all the triggers. They're all pretty self-explanatory, and it'll give you something a little bit to go out and explore on your own. But let's talk about the other overlay panel type, the anchored panels. The anchored panel works really similar to everything we just built, except instead of the position being relative to your viewport, you can anchor it to a specific element on your page. Let me show you what I mean by that. Back on the front end of the site, you can see there's a user icon at the corner of the header. If I hover over that icon, you'll see the flyout menu appear with all the links for the account details. This works off the same overlay panel system, but instead of being placed relative to the viewport, it's anchored to this image. Everything we talked about in our pop-up example still applies, except we need to make a tiny tweak to the positioning. Let's go ahead and set up one from scratch just for a little bit of extra practice. We'll use the admin bar this time to get back to our overlay panel screen, and we'll use the drop-down menu to select the anchored panel. Let's call this one Account Details Menu and take a look at our settings. We can see the panel type is already set to anchored, so we can move down to the trigger type. By default, it's set to click, but I think I want to change that to click or hover. Since this panel is going to appear below our image, we want to select bottom right. This way, it will be anchored to the bottom right of our image. Next, we need to go ahead and tell our panel what element it needs to be anchored to. In this case, we want to anchor it to that profile image. Now, I haven't set up a class on that image yet, but we can go ahead and type in a class here now, and then we'll go add it to our image when we're done. I'll go ahead and type in header profile image and set my animation styles. Now, just like we did on the last pop-up, I've already designed this menu, so I'm gonna go ahead and paste it in here just so you don't have to see me adding containers and links to the pages. But now that this is all set up, we can go ahead and save this anchored menu, and we can go add that class to the profile image inside of our header. Back on the front end of the site, I'm gonna go under my elements and open up my header. Now I'm actually going to select the container that's wrapping around my image here, and we're just going to paste in that header profile image class. That will just make sure that our menu is anchored to this box that's holding the image, which is exactly where I want it to be positioned. Of course, we also need to tell this to trigger that modal, so down here under Advanced, under Overlay Panel Trigger, I'm going to select our Account Details menu so it knows which menu I want to open up when we hover or click on that profile image. So with that, we'll go ahead and save our changes. And now when we view things on the front end, we can hover or click on this container and it's gonna open up that little flyout menu, which is exactly what we were after. You'll see that it's nicely anchored to the bottom right of that container holding the image. So that's the position I wanted for this. But of course, you might have a different scenario where you need to position things differently, but you have all those controls. Now, as I experimented with this feature, I came up with a few different ways you might want to use these anchored menus, so I'll go ahead and flash a few of my crude Figma mockups on the screen. Now, like I said earlier, I already did a dedicated video just on the mega menu, and it works really similar to the way the anchored menu works here, except that it's anchored to your menu instead of anchoring it to a specific element. I'll make sure to include a link to that video at the end of this one, but let's talk about those display conditions. If you've worked with the Block Visibility plugin before, this should feel really familiar. Essentially, the display conditions give us a system to be able to show or hide our overlay panels by creating a set of rules. Let's go back into our timed pop-up example. Right now, this pop-up is going to show up everywhere on our website since we didn't set a display condition. But maybe you only want to show this pop-up on specific pages or to certain users, maybe based on device or query parameter or refer. The conditions allow you to do all of that and more. Next to our display condition dropdown, where we'd be able to select any of the conditions we've already configured, we have a plus button to be able to open up the conditions and build a new one from scratch. We'll go ahead and click that and give it a name. For a test, let's set up a condition that only shows when a URL has the query parameter of popup equals true. It's not a super practical use case, but it'll be a great one for testing. So we'll call this condition popup equals true, and we can start building out our conditions. We can stack multiple conditions together, which is why we have the option for the logic of either and or. In this case, we're only setting up one condition, so it doesn't matter which one we choose. Next to the if, let's go ahead and select query parameter from the list. As you can see, we have a ton of conditions available to us, each one with their own unique set of rules inside of them. The next part of our condition is where we can decide what we want to check against this query parameter. We have exists, contains, equals, and all the opposites of those, which gives us a ton of flexibility. In this case, we're going to choose equals and put our parameter name and value. We'll put popup as the name and true as the value. If we wanted to add more conditions, we can use the button to add another rule or even create a separate or group. This makes this system extremely flexible to handle a whole matter of scenarios, but let's just keep this simple. We'll save our condition and then close the conditions panel. Now, under the display conditions, we can choose popup equals true from our list. What's nice about being able to create and save these conditions is you might have some conditions you want to reuse on various panels across your website. You don't have to build a condition for each one of them individually, you can just reuse the same one across as many panels as you'd like. We'll save those changes and go test things out on the front end. If I just open the URL, you'll see the popup never opens. However, if I add the popup equals true query parameter to the URL and reload the page, our popup shows up right away. These parameters are a great way to build some conditional logic into your page so you can have more personalized content for each user. Say you're sending some traffic to your site from all your social platforms and you want to give those visitors a unique offer. You can link to the site with the parameter in place and those people will see the popup, but anyone else visiting the site won't be bothered with it. These conditions are extremely powerful, and even though they just needed to build this functionality in order to get the overlay panels to work, I can't see a reason why they wouldn't introduce the same system into all the other blocks in the ecosystem. Having that inside GenerateBlocks would pretty much eliminate the need for using block visibility, and that's a plugin I use on just about every website I build. I'm certainly going to have to make some more videos dedicated to all these display conditions because we're only scratching the surface with what you can do, but hopefully for now you at least have an idea how the system works and your mind spinning with all the possibilities of things you could create with it. This 2.3 release is probably going to keep my content calendar full for quite a while, but what I really want to know is what questions you have and what kind of things you'd like to see me build out, so make sure to let me know down in the comments. I'll go ahead and pop up that mega menu on the screen now so you can go ahead and check that out next. But if you enjoyed today's video, I would really appreciate a thumbs up. And if you want to make sure to see all the content I create around this 2.3 release, then hit subscribe and we'll see you then.